In late 2013, I had the chance to travel to Iran, a country mostly known in our Western world for its nuclear program and religiously oriented government. Usually making the headlines for all the wrong reasons. There had to be more to a country with such a long history. I consider myself very lucky to finally touch down in Tehran, ready to explore uncharted territory. Iran became the Islamic Republic of Iran in 1979, in a series of events that shook the world and shaped Iranian relations with the West to this very day. In this year, Ayatollah Khomeini overthrew the US-backed government of Mohammad Reza Shah, supported by Islamic groups, students, liberals, and other revolutionary forces. The following hostage crisis at the US Embassy in Tehran, in which 52 Americans were held hostage for well over a year, led to a bitter relationship between Iran and the United States, characterized by decades of mistrust and accusations. To understand the widespread anger that led to the revolution, it is crucial to mention what happened 26 years earlier, in 1953. After years of semi-colonial struggle with the British, the election of Mohammad Mossadegh as Prime Minister was considered by many to be a first real step towards democracy in Iran. What happened next has had a profound effect on Iran's position in the world today. For a number of reasons, Mossadegh's government was overthrown in a coup d'etat, orchestrated by the American CIA and British intelligence services. The Shah, who had been forced to temporarily leave the country, returned to Iran. Although widely popular in, and also financially supported by the West, his oppressive rule quickly turned Iranians against him, eventually culminating in the shattering 1979 revolution. These images shaped Western popular opinion in the decades that followed. Economic sanctions were put in place by the United States, and the diverse population of Iran now had to follow strict Islamic rules. Shortly after the revolution, Iran was attacked by Saddam Hussein's Iraq, resulting in 8 years of war. The Iran-Iraq War, also known as the First Persian Gulf War, cost hundreds of thousands of lives. Ironically, the war solidified support for the Shaky Revolution by providing an obvious enemy to rally against. Ayatollah Khomeini remained in power until his death in 1989. When he was succeeded by Ruhollah Khamenei. Traveling through Iran and speaking to the people on the streets, it became clear to me that all of these events have had an enormous effect on society. Islam had become the state religion, and people are now expected to abide to Islamic law. Probably the most obvious example can be found by just walking the streets of any city or town. Since the revolution, all the women in Iran are required by law to wear loose-fitting clothing and cover their hair. Mosques are found everywhere and are often busy during prayer time. Officially, 99% of Iran's population are Muslim, the vast majority of which follow Shia Islam as opposed to Sunni. Although many people I met were firm believers, others I spoke to had a more liberal view on religion, particularly in capital Tehran and other large cities. Bazaars, the quintessential Persian marketplaces, remain the place where people do their shopping. All across the country, Iranians rely on these mazes of covered lanes for clothing, spices, garments, household items and many other things. Many bazaars have become UNESCO World Heritage Sites. At the same time, it is precisely in these bazaars that the effects of the economic sanctions become visible. Previously flourishing businesses are struggling, and many merchants have been put out of work because of export restrictions and rising inflation. Perhaps needless to say, the average Iranian seems to be paying a hefty price for the political rivalry between the government and the West. One might assume the economic sanctions and Iran's isolation from the international scene have strengthened the animosity towards the US government that was so commonly found in the streets since the revolution. About halfway during my trip, I witnessed a nationwide protest in which the 34th anniversary of the takeover of the US embassy in Tehran, which led to the hostage crisis, was celebrated. The message was clear. Organized by the government, high school students had gathered to take part in the protest. With the common travel warning to avoid demonstrations, rallies and large crowds in the back of my mind, I decided to take my chances. In between chanting "Death to America" and burning the US flag, I actually found most students to be curious about my presence. Many young men were eager to have their photo taken, and some even asked for my autograph. It was a refreshingly different look at something that seemed so aggressive, and a reminder that not everything is what it seems in Iran. Iran holds a strategic position in the Middle East, or West Asia, sharing land borders with countries like Afghanistan, Iraq, and Pakistan. Its most important economic assets and top export products are located on the Persian Gulf. Traveling across the Gulf reveals glimpses of Iran's massive oil and gas reserves, some of the largest in the world. These were the main source of conflict between Iran and British colonial forces in the first half of the 20th century. They also proved a reason for Iraq's Saddam Hussein to attack Iran and start the first Persian Gulf War. At the same time, revenues from the petroleum industry now provide the Iranian government with large funds to support and subsidize other parts of the economy. The same Persian Gulf also has many fishing grounds, and traveling in the region reveals a different, almost nostalgic Iran. Keshf Island, off the coast of Bandar Abbas in the south, is home to many small fishing communities. Fishermen go out to sea in small boats in the early morning to return at dusk. After bringing in the catch, the fish are sold at local markets before being transported to other parts of the island or mainland Iran. Traditionally hand-built lanch vessels are also still produced on the island. These large wooden cargo boats have crisscrossed the Persian Gulf for centuries, although modern alternatives are gradually taking over. Back on the mainland, driving from one city to another, I couldn't help but wonder about life in the villages. Central Iran is mostly desert territory, and with nearly 80 million people to feed, agricultural opportunity seemed limited. Yet fertile pockets of land were found around cities, and people could be seen working in fields, in the most unexpected of places. Herdsmen could be seen guiding their flock of sheep and goats through empty deserts, resisting the soaring heat of summer. Or in some cases, the bitter cold of winter. This tucked away mountain settlement in northwestern Iran provided a unique insight in the daily life of a small village community. And in some ways felt like stepping back in time. Grain and wheat is cultivated wherever possible, providing crucial ingredients for bread, one of the main staple foods in Iran. After a few decades of struggling output, Iran is now once again self-sufficient food production. In the eyes of Western travelers, Iran may not be the most obvious tourist destination. Yet the country has an amazing galore of culture and history on offer. ancient Persia evokes images of once great empires, led by inspiring but ruthless kings. Names like Cyrus the Great resonate in the ruins of Persepolis, located in the heartland of the Achaemenid Empire. Iran has been home to organized urban settlements that date back even further, suggesting it is truly one of the great civilizations in the world. Some traditions live on, like Zurkane, literally meaning house of strength, usually performed inside a covered dome. This sport is probably best described as ancient bodybuilding and is still widely practiced in Iran. No wonder then that many Iranians like to explore their own country. Probably the most popular place to visit is Isfahan, famous for its exceptional Islamic architecture, palaces, mosques, riches, and the majestic Nakhch-i-Jahan Square, the centerpiece of the city. Isfahan flourished for nearly seven centuries, especially under the Safavid Empire in the 16th century, and boasts a great number of attractions. The many artisans that still work in the bazaars and narrow alleys underpin its reputation as a living museum of cultural history. After nearly 4 weeks of travel, I had the choice to go home or extend my visa and stay a bit longer, in a country that had already captured my attention in so many ways. On my way back to Tehran, I visited Qom, the second most religious city in Iran, giving me an exceptional insight in the practices and rituals of ordinary Muslims. Men and women, old and young, families and friends, come here from all over Iran and beyond to visit the shrine of Fatima, an important figure in Shia Islam. Iran differs from most Islamic countries by adopting an alternative version of the Islam. When the Prophet Muhammad died in the year 632 in the Western calendar, there was disagreement over his rightful successor. While the majority backed the Prophet's father-in-law and friend Abu Bakr, others supported the claim of the Prophet's son-in-law and cousin, Ali. The former group became known as Sunni Muslims, whereas those choosing Ali are now called Shia. Iran has the largest Shia community in the world, accounting for about 89% of the total population. The appointment of Ali as successor is therefore widely celebrated during Eid al-Qadir. While religion plays an important part in society, the works of Hafez, a poet who lived in Persian times, may have an even greater role. In Shiraz, I came across public poetry lessons. Iranians have a saying that every home must have two things. First, the Quran. Then a collection of the works of Hafez. Judging some of the emotions at the scene, it is not that hard to imagine many would reverse that order. The reason to stay a bit longer came after experiencing some events leading up to Ashura, the most important and passionate date on the Shia Islamic calendar. After successfully extending my visa, I headed out to Zanjan, in the northwest, to witness some of the most intense religious ceremonies I had ever seen.
Yeah.
Ashura marks the martyrdom of Imam Hussein, who was killed in the Battle of Karbala, along with most of his family and companions. It is celebrated with somber parades, religious theater, and public prayer sessions. People mourn for days on end and find support with friends and family, creating an unforgettable feeling of togetherness. Having come to Iran as open-minded as possible, in the end the country and its people have shattered perceptions I, and probably other foreigners with me, have had for years. The friendly, welcome attitude of so many Iranians has been overwhelming. From the liberal voices I have heard in the cities, to the more conservative people I met elsewhere, all shared a common curiosity towards the visitor and a world beyond the borders of Iran. Certainly, there are many challenges ahead for all those involved. As an outsider, I have only begun to scratch the surface. And it would take years, if not decades, to fully grasp this complex society. That having said, if travel is most interesting when it surprises, then Iran might just be the most eye-opening destination in the world.